Thus far, we've considered the oxidation and catabolism of carbohydrates in the form of glucose, a monosaccharide, a sugar. But there is also catabolism of protein and fat. They are also broken down, in other words, through catabolic biochemical pathways. So let's look at this at a very superficial level, and let's first look at the catabolism of proteins. As you know, proteins are made out of amino acids, and also, as you know, an amino acid has the basic structure NH2, alpha carbon, R group, hydrogen, and then an acid group. And here is the amino part of an amino acid, and here is the acidic part of an amino acid. And these are joined together through peptide bonds, as we've already discussed. Well, amino acids can be broken, proteins can be hydrolyzed into their constituent amino acids as the first step of catabolism. And then each individual amino acid can undergo deamination, meaning breaking off of the amino group. And the nitrogen-containing amino groups are usually produced as a waste product, urea, that is excreted and as a waste product. And after that, the remainder of the amino acids, here we have a alpha carbon with the R group and the acidic group attached to it, the carboxy group. The remainder of the amino acid can be converted into molecules that enter glycolysis, or it can enter the Krebs cycle. So for example, alanine, the amino acid alanine, is converted to pyruvate. And we know what happens to pyruvate. Pyruvate can be oxidized to acetyl coenzyme A, and CO2 can be released. One of the carbons of pyruvate leaves as a carbon in a carbon dioxide molecule. So alanine can be converted to pyruvate, and what do we know happens to acetyl-CoA? That can enter the Krebs cycle. And that will yield energy by producing 1 ATP per turn of the Krebs cycle, plus, of course, our electron-carrying cofactors, NADH and FADH2, which, as you know, can be utilized in the electron transport chain to promote oxidative phosphorylation with concomitant high yields of ATP. Also, here's another example. Aspartate, another amino acid. These are two of the 20 different amino acids found in proteins. Aspartate can be converted to oxaloacetate. And where is oxaloacetate found? Oxaloacetate, remember, is the molecule which is joined to the acetyl group of acetyl coenzyme A to form citric acid in the first step of the Krebs cycle. So those are two examples of that. Turning now to the catabolism of fats, fats are components of glycerol and fatty acids attached to that glycerol molecule. That is, they're triglycerides. And glycerol can be removed, the fatty acid chains, the fatty acid tails on triglycerides can be removed from glycerol. And then the fatty acids, which are long hydrocarbons, as you'll remember, they could be converted to acetyl groups by a process called beta oxidation. And we'll go over that in a minute. And the point here, the important point here, is that if you have a 6-carbon fatty acid, which is a rather short fatty acid even, that can yield 20% more energy than glucose. And why do you think that is? The reason for that is that if you have a long chain of hydrocarbons, which are the long tails of fatty acids, and this might go on for quite a ways in either direction, you can immediately see that, well, we can break off the chunks of this as acetyl groups, as 2-carbon acetyl groups. And what do we know about acetyl groups. We know that those can be joined to coenzyme A. Coenzyme A here can come in, and we can form acetyl coenzyme A. And what do we know about that? We know that CoA can donate the acetyl group, the two carbon acetyl group to, guess what, the Krebs cycle. And we know what happens in the Krebs cycle, so we don't need to go over that again. This will end up producing lots of energy especially via our reduced electron carriers, NADH and FADH2. So the respiration of a 6-carbon fatty acid can yield 20% more energy than a glucose molecule. That's why acids are such great energy storage. That's why fats are such wonderful energy storage molecules. They can produce lots of acetate groups, which can be joined to coenzyme A to form acetyl coenzyme A, which will end up forming lots of energy through the Krebs cycle. So let's look at that beta oxidation process. Here we have a fatty acid, and this is the acid part here, and this would be joined to, normally that would be joined to the glycerol, but it's been broken off of glycerol, and this might go on for a long chain here. We're not showing it all. Well, we invest a little bit of ATP in this beta oxidation process, and here's coenzyme A coming in to play another role. So we can attach the fatty acid, and this might be a long chain fatty acid. We're only showing a few carbons here. It could be very long. We use ATP hydrolysis to provide energy for the attachment of coenzyme A to the fatty acid at this carbon, at the carboxyl carbon. And then we oxidize that fatty acid with FAD, which is reduced to FADH2. So this is a redox reaction. And then we add water to the remaining fatty acid and produce a situation in which this molecule can be further oxidized by, in this case, being coupled to NAD reduction to NADH. So here's another redox reaction. And now we're left with a fatty acid attached to coenzyme A. And this will break this oxidation by concomitant reduction of NAD will break off a 2-carbon compound attached to coenzyme A. That is, we will now have acetyl coenzyme A. And that, of course, can enter the Krebs cycle with the subsequent yield of energy that we know so well now. When coenzyme A donates its two carbons, that its acetyl coenzyme A donates the two carbons, the acetyl group, to the Krebs cycle, we regenerate coenzyme A, and we now have a fatty acid which is 2 carbons shorter than it was before. So we come up here, we can add coenzyme A again to a fatty acid, and now that fatty acid is 2 carbons shorter, and we can repeat this process cyclically until the fatty acid is completely broken down, removing 2 carbons at a time as acetyl groups attached to coenzyme A that will then enter the Krebs cycle. So this yields a lot of energy because of the role of acetyl coenzyme A in donating 2-carbon compounds to the Krebs cycle. And if we do a large overview of catabolism and also anabolism, let's start with polysaccharides, which we know well, which are our sugars linked together. Those can be broken down into individual sugars, and those can be converted to glucose, which can then enter glycolysis, producing pyruvate and acetyl coenzyme A, which enters the Krebs cycle, as we know well. So we've kind of studied this catabolism well. There is a reverse in that pyruvate can be converted to sugars. Most of the reactions going from glycolysis are reversible, so we can get sugars back out by an anabolic process building up of this. These are reversible processes. Now, what about proteins? As we've already discussed, proteins can be broken down into individual amino acids. They can be catabolized into individual amino acids. And of course, amino acids are anabolized in anabolic metabolic pathways into proteins. Amino acids are linked together by peptide bonds to form proteins. But amino acids can be broken down further. And we've already given you an example of alanine being converted to pyruvate, and we know what happens to pyruvate in terms of generating energy. Amino acids can also be broken down into Krebs cycle intermediates, like oxaloacetate, and others as well. Nucleic acids, are DNA and RNA, can be broken down into individual nucleotides, which can also enter through biochemical catabolic processes, can enter the Krebs cycle as intermediates by various biochemical pathways that we won't go into right now. And those will also produce, as the degradation of amino acids produces amino groups, so the degradation of nucleotides, which after all have nitrogenous bases, they contain nitrogen, those can yield NH3 as well. And this is kind of an ultimate metabolic product that will need to be converted to something that can be excreted, like urea, as I've already mentioned. Let's look at lipids and fats now. We've discussed beta oxidation. We can break down lipids and fats to fatty acids. And of course, fatty acids can join with glycerol to form triglycerides and form lipids and fats. And the fatty acids, as we've discussed, can be oxidized through beta oxidation to produce lots of acetyl coenzyme A. And we know the fate of that in terms of energy production. Now, acetyl coenzyme A in anabolic processes can build up fatty acids, long chain fatty acids, by donating two carbons to a growing fatty acid chain. All the up arrows here are energy requiring, are anabolic, and most of the steps in those processes are endergonic reactions that require an input of energy, as we've already discussed. And so ATP dephosphorylation and hydrolysis is used to provide energy for the up arrows here. And of course, all these down arrows represent catabolic or breakdown processes, which yield energy for the most part. And the ultimate metabolic products of these catabolic processes are CO2, as we've mentioned, water, as we've mentioned, and amino groups, which will be excreted as urea, as we've already mentioned. So this is the big picture of metabolism in cells. And if you have a general idea of what's going on here for this class, that's fine. Later on in biochemistry, you'll study some of these processes in great detail. So next we'll move on to consider the evolution of metabolism.